Hey guys, I'm Venkat, and in this video, we'll discuss how indexes actually work and help improve the performance of our SQL queries. We'll discuss how both the index types work, clustered and non-clustered. If you're new to indexes, we have already covered all the basics you need in this SQL Server tutorial for beginners course. Please check out the videos from parts 35 to 38. I'll include the link in the description of this video. Now, consider this employees table. Employee ID is the primary key. So by default, a clustered index on the employee ID column is created. This means employee data is sorted by employee ID column and physically stored in a series of data pages in a tree-like structure that looks like the following. The nodes at the bottom of the tree are called data pages or leaf nodes and contains the actual data rows, in our case, employee rows. These employee rows are sorted by employee ID column because employee ID is the primary key, and by default, a clustered index on this column is created. For our example, let's say in this employees table, we have 1200 rows, and let's assume in each data page, we have 200 rows. So in the first data page, we have 1 to 200 rows. In the second, 201 to 400. In the third, 401 to 600, so on and so forth. The node at the top of the tree is called root node. The nodes between the root node and the leaf nodes are called intermediate levels. The root and the intermediate level nodes contain index rows. Each index row contains a key value, in our case, employee ID, and a pointer to either an intermediate level page in the B tree or a data row in the leaf node. So this tree-like structure has a series of pointers that helps the query engine find data quickly. For example, let's say we want to find employee row with employee ID 1120. So the database engine starts at the root node and it picks the index node on the right because the database engine knows it is this node that contains employee IDs from 801 to 1200. From there, it picks the leaf node that is present on the extreme right because employee data rows from 1001 to 1200 are present in this leaf node. The data rows in the leaf node are sorted by employee ID, so it's easy for the database engine to find the employee row with ID equals 1120. Notice, in just three operations, SQL Server is able to find the data we are looking for. It's making use of the clustered index we have on the table. Let's look at this in action. This piece of SQL script at the top creates employees table with these four columns, ID, name, email, and department. First, let's create the table. This second block of code here inserts test data into employees table. Let's actually execute the script. It's going to take a few seconds to complete. And that's because if you take a look at this code, notice we're using while loop to insert 1 million rows into this table. And if we click on the messages tab, in a few seconds, we should see a message saying 100,000 rows inserted. That's because for every 100,000 rows that we insert, we aren't logging the message. Let's give it a few seconds to complete. There we go. All the 1 million rows are inserted. Now let's execute this select query. We are trying to find employee whose ID is 932,000. And before we execute this query, click on this icon right here, which includes the actual execution plan. You can also use the keyboard shortcut Control M. There we go. We got the one row that we expected. And when I click on the execution plan, and when I hover over this, notice the operation is clustered index seek, meaning the database engine is using the clustered index on the employee ID column to find the employee row we want. Number of rows read is 1. Actual number of rows for all executions is also 1. Now, number of rows read is the number of rows SQL Server has to read to produce the query result. In our case, employee ID is unique, so we expect 1 row, and that is represented by actual number of rows for all executions. With the help of the index, SQL Server is able to directly read that one specific employee row we want. Hence, both number of rows read and actual number of rows for all executions is 1. So the point is, if there are thousands or even millions of records, SQL Server can easily and quickly find the data we are looking for, provided there is an index that can help the query find data. Now, we have a clustered index on the employee ID column, so when we search by employee ID, SQL Server can easily and quickly find the data we are looking for. But what if we search by employee name? At the moment, there is no index on the name column, so there is no easy way for SQL Server to find the data we are looking for. SQL Server has to read every record in the table, which is extremely inefficient from a performance standpoint. Let's actually look at this in action. Here is the query. We are trying to find the employee by name. Let's execute it. There we go. We have the one row that we expected. When I click on the execution plan and hover over this, notice the operation is clustered index scan. Since there is no proper index to help this query, the database engine has no other choice than to read every record in the table. This is exactly the reason why number of rows read is 1 million, that is every row in the table. And if you take a look at actual number of rows for all executions, the value is 1. How many rows are we expecting in the result? Well, only one row, because there is only one employee whose name is ABC 932,000. So to produce this one row as the result, SQL Server has to read all the 1 million rows from the table, because there is no index to help this query. This is called index scan, and in general, index scans are bad for performance. This is when we create a non-clustered index on the name column. Actually, SQL Server is helping us here. Notice, it's actually telling us there is a missing index. To improve the performance of this select query, it's asking us to create a non-clustered index on the name column. Why on the name column? Well, that's because we are looking up employees by name. So let's actually right-click on this and select this option, missing index details. We actually have the required code here to create non-clustered index. Let's uncomment this, create non-clustered index. We are creating on the name column, and let's give this index a name, IX for index. We are creating it on the employees table and on the name column. Let's execute this. Now, let's execute that same select query again. Click on the execution plan tab, and we have several steps here. We'll discuss execution plans in detail in our upcoming videos. For now, just understand we read the execution plans from right to left and top to bottom. So we start here. And when I hover over this, notice now the operation is index seek on the non-clustered index. Before we understand this execution plan, let's first understand how non-clustered index is stored in the database. In a non-clustered index, we do not have table data. We have key values and row locators. We created a non-clustered index on the name column. So the key values, in this case, employee names, are sorted and stored in alphabetical order. The row locators that are present at the bottom of the tree contain employee names and cluster key of the row. In our example, employee ID is the cluster key. Why? Because employee ID is the primary key. By default, it is the cluster key. Now, if we look at one of the row locators, notice the names of the employees are sorted in alphabetical order, and we also have their respective employee ID. Now, if you remember, on the employee ID, we have the clustered index. Now, when we search employee by name, both these indexes, non-clustered index on the name column and clustered index on the employee ID column, are going to work together to find the employee that we are looking for. Let's look at the steps involved. First, SQL Server uses the non-clustered index on the name column to quickly find this employee entry in the index. In the non-clustered index, along with the employee name, we also have the cluster key. In our case, it's employee ID. The database engine knows there is clustered index on employee ID. So this clustered index is then used to find the respective employee record. Now, let's relate these steps to the execution plan that we have in SQL Server Management Studio. Remember, we read the execution plan from right to left and top to bottom. So we start on the top right here. Notice the first step is index seek on the non-clustered index. On the name column, we have non-clustered index, and SQL Server is using it to find an entry for this employee in the index. And remember, in the index, along with the employee name, we also have employee ID, which is the primary key. Next, this primary key is used to find an entry in the clustered index. That's why we have the operation here as key lookup clustered. The value from the clustered index, in our case employee ID, is then used in an inner join with the employees table to retrieve the respective employees record. If you're new to these execution plans and wondering why this nested loop or inner join is required, we'll discuss these execution plans in detail in our upcoming videos. Now, on this slide, I have estimated subtree cost with and without index. So for this query, select star from employees, where name equals whatever name we supply, estimated subtree cost without index is 11 point something. With index, it is 0.006. Just imagine the impact it can have on performance if we don't have index on the name column. If you're wondering, how did I get these statistics? Well, in SQL Server Management Studio, on the execution plan tab, if you hover over the select operation, you get the total estimated subtree cost for all these operations. In our upcoming videos in the series, we'll discuss SQL Server execution plans in detail with examples. That's it in this video. Thank you for listening.